Oh, wow. I mean, a 5-0 lead. Could the script have been written any better for Liverpool? Their 10th appearance in the semi-final of the European Cup / Champions League saw them absolutely destroy a Roma side that has reached this stage for the first time in 27 years. And it looked like it was a night they would have wanted to forget in a hurry. But what a dramatic end to that match. Liverpool copping two goals there certainly made it interesting. And Foz, you made the comment, off the back of what we've seen the last couple of weeks in the Champions League, you said that football's gone mad.
It has recently.
And rightfully so.
Yeah, and isn't it fantastic to see a game with so much attack, up and down the field, wonderful intensity, two teams just going at it. I thought that Di Francesco just waited too long, though, to change
to go to a back four.
Yeah. And once he did, I know that Salah then went off shortly afterwards anyway. That's true. However, it was a much better structure for Roma, and all of a sudden they weren't getting counter-attacked at will. I mean, it was just ridiculous. The first 15 minutes of that second half was outstanding to watch, but it really was just extraordinary to think that every time the ball went to Mane or Salah, they're free and they're just running into space. It was just, it was crazy for an Italian team. Spider, you just...
No, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Thinking 2-0 at half-time, you thought Roma would have stabilised the ship, got a bit of structure, but structure went out the window. It was a free-for-all, and goals are plenty. Look, I always say, if we're getting up at this time of the morning, Foz, we might as well get some entertainment.
Well, that's true. We were certainly entertained.
We were very entertained by that, Patrick. Liverpool fans will be feeling a little bit disgruntled, as will Jurgen Klopp. The fact that they allowed Roma to get back into that game after they capitulated so epically will be disappointing for him, won't it?
Yeah, oh, definitely. Like, after 5-0, I was thinking, I went to the Man United Roma game in 2007. I got tickets from Vendezar, and it was 7-1 that game. And it was unreal. And then when it was 5-0 after 60 minutes, I was thinking, oh, my God, I've seen this game before.
Well, I think what they've done, Roma has made it quite simple for everyone to see. Oh. They need to win 3-0. So they thought, look, we've done it against Barcelona. Why would we want
to... Make it happen again?
Yeah, let's just do it again.
5-2, 3-0, we go through. Why do you ever want to put yourself in that situation?
But you know what? Up to then, I mean, Liverpool, what a performance.
Yeah.
I mean, not just Mo Salah, but, on the counter-attack. But the thing about a back three is, we're talking about it here, is if you play it against a team that's strong and counter-attack, and this is why Liverpool do so well against Manchester City, is because you have to be superior in the game and you must have total control of the game. And so you've got to force some of that back three to go back and defend. That means you're usually going to have control of the ball, a lot of possession, and take time to build forward. If you are going to play a back three against this front three, and then you're going to play forward quickly and lose the ball in midfield repeatedly, you are in deep trouble. And the thing is, it's not working. And when it's not working with a back three, and that's happening, so your system is not applying well against this, it has to be changed. And I just don't understand why Di Francesco took so long to change it, particularly first 5-8 minutes of second half. It hasn't worked. You're getting absolutely slaughtered against one of the best players in the world right now, Mo Salah. He is taking you to pieces. I mean, when you see the ball played into him and he's got open space in your half and he's just running, he's not even running at defenders, he's running into space.
The players are scared.
You're in trouble.
The players are scared of him. As soon as he receives the ball, they don't even want to engage. They don't want to engage because they're so scared of what he's going to do to them.
But the commentator made such a great point, and you echoed it, Spider, where he said the Roma have just stopped.
Yeah. Yeah.
But why? Because we've spoken about the resilience of this Roma team, but also for an Italian team, we're used to seeing them so structured and so disciplined. Why did it all go out the window?
No, it was strange because, I mean, we've spoken about it. Roma's away record is poor. Their away record is poor.
Yeah, a lot of goals conceded.
A lot of goals conceded, and they're coming against a team that attacks at will. I think they lost their discipline. Like, they held their discipline for 15 minutes of the first half. After that, it was a free-for-all. And rightly so, Liverpool punished them.
Come on.
Ridiculous. But I'd like to know what leads to that lack of discipline.
That's confidence as well. I mean, when Liverpool scored, and I mean, Anfield rocks. And they keep attacking and you can't keep hold of them. But for some reason, we've all been footballers, we all know what it is. For some reason, under pressure, you can't keep the ball. It just keeps bouncing off you. They've got the ball again. You're defending again. It just makes it so difficult. And it seems like just a relentless, relentless flow of attack that you can't get out of your own half. Like, Roma didn't have a shot on goal until they scored. Like, it's scary.
So, but also, even then, I mean, here, this is what we're talking about. So, you know, you've got the most informed player in the world, quite possibly right now, aside from Cristiano Ronaldo, particularly in the Champions League, and, of course, Leo. But what he's doing is extraordinary. And you're put yourself in a situation repeatedly in a Champions League semi-final that he's receiving ball in acres of space and being able to run. And you've got, what, you've got 20 metres to try and adjust the cross to it.
But no one affects him. Well, like, I don't understand why he doesn't come out and affect him outside.
Why are they not closing him down?
But this is the thing. We talk about it here with our grassroots in Australia and our A-League players here. This is happening at the top level. That shows me one thing of how scared they are of this player. They don't want to be engaging and him getting past him. But you're better off engaging out there than letting him come into the box and do that to you.
But is it a problem that you say, like, everybody needs to play well, we need to play great football? Back in the days when you were in Milan, it was just, we, man, whatever we do, if we have 25% of the ball, we'll get the zero, and even we can one, we can win 1-0, perfect, but we don't want to play beautiful football.
Now, Roma could have lost this game 3-1 and still been in the tie. This is the thing. They threw this match away. They threw this match away. They almost put up the white flag. Like, we've all played in matches where you have to be resilient. You have to defend for your life. You're going away to a very unfriendly environment where a team is very strong at home and you're actually very poor away from home. You have to be resilient.
Okay, so you mentioned there that Roma, which is a fact, have a poor record away from home. We saw what happened when they took on Barca away 4-1. Then they go back to the Stadio Olimpico. Okay, it's a different result here, 5-2. But can you comfortably say, Foz, off the back of what they did to Barca, that this tie, this second leg tie, is cooked?
I tell you why you can't say unequivocally no is because Liverpool also defensively are very ordinary.
They're a shambles
right.
at times.
And so you're going, they're leading 2-0 and they go and concede two against West Brom, right?
What a goal, by the way.
Yeah, and you see here with Lovren, the defending in the air. So Liverpool can concede. So there's a good chance that Roma are going to score at home. The problem why it is overwhelmingly likely to be over is because Salah will score again, Firmino will score, or Mane will score away from home. Because now, of course, Roma have to come and chase it. But the speed that they have on the counter-attack, you've seen today, it's scintillating. It is actually quicker than the way that Barca are playing. Barca are going to slow down their attack a lot. These guys are not going to slow down anything. No. They want to go forward in one pass if possible, two is next, maybe three maximum. They want to be arriving at your goal. And so they're one of the best in the world at doing that right now. And that's what Roma are scared of. So I think they're definitely going to score in the second leg.
What about this for a penalty, by the way, Patrick?
Yeah, it's under pressure, and he just came on. He came on after they changed the back four. Exactly. And had a great penalty, good finish. You will never stop that. Doesn't matter which keeper there. The problem will be, as Foss said, going home, Roma will get behind again. They start to believe in the Barcelona story. If you look at a few years ago, is it 2 years ago, that Barcelona lost 4-0 against PSG, came home, won 6-1. Mm. The next tie was Juventus. They lost away 3-0, so similar there. And at home was 0-0. They were never in the second game after. They were not in it anymore. So I fear for Roma that they can't do it again.
You can only have so many miracles.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, well, anything can happen in football. But let's talk about the front three, because they've now scored 28 goals in this campaign alone between the three of them. But from a statistical point of view as well, Liverpool also leading the tally in terms of goals scored in this campaign. But they've also scored, Foz, the most amount of goals by an English team in Champions League / European Cup history.
In one campaign.
Right. Remarkable. And they are, of Fantastic. Course, the only English team remaining at this stage of the campaign. But it's not the front three or the goal-scoring abilities that are the concern. It's at the back. How does Klopp correct this? I mean, is this something that can be done from a tactical perspective, or is it down to individuals? Because Lovren wasn't very good today either.
No. And so when was it against Sevilla where they were leading 3-0?
Correct.
Ended up,
yes.
What, 3-3?
Yeah. That was in the group
was
stage.
It was very similar to this. They did it against West Brom recently as well. So they seem to have a problem on being able to defend this type of lead. But secondly, if you have a look at their back four, Alexander-Arnold is very young, Robertson also, but it is not the best back four in the world, right? It is an area where Van Dijk, I think, was a fantastic signing. But I think, a bit like Man City, to go on and consistently achieve at this level, you need the best in central defence, mm-hmm. because with and without the ball, it's critical. And that's one key reason. Keep talking about Sergio Ramos. I love him. I think he's the best competitor in world football. And you saw what happened when he wasn't in recently. And they got done at home at the Bernabeu, right? 100%. Because leadership, that's quality with the ball, interceptions, timing of tackles, and making sure people are doing their jobs. The issue for Roma, though, as well, on another note, is in set pieces, they were horrible today.
Bad. They were so un-Italian today. It was unbelievable.
He had three free headers at the back post.
Yeah.
And then they conceded one in the second half.
It was incredible. Like, to think they would have done set pieces 2 days before.
They are so structurally
aware of it, and to actually concede goals from it is something they're going to regret.
Free headers. Yeah. Free headers around the six-yard box. Yeah. Three, four, five times in one game.
Terrible.
That's incredible.
It is incredible. All right, let's for the moment take a break and head back to Anfield, where the captain, Jordan Henderson, is standing by.
Jordan, thank you for joining Fox Sports. For 80 minutes, it was a superb Liverpool performance. Conceding those two late goals, does that take the shine off the display tonight a little bit for you?
Possibly, yeah. We'll be disappointed. We obviously conceded the two goals. I felt one of them was really harsh in the penalty with his hands by. I felt as though down the side. Obviously, you'll know better looking at a replay. So I felt that was harsh. But we're for 10 minutes, we didn't play as well. And we got punished, really. But overall, I think you've got to take that result to go over there, and we've got to put on a good performance, which we knew we would. It'll never be easy in the Champions League, especially in the semi. So, tough place to go, but we need to be ready and focused on what the job is.
It's the second game in a row you've conceded two late goals going back into the Premier League against West Brom. Is there something you can pinpoint yourself that's gone wrong, or is it a case of just being better collectively?
Well, yeah, you're right. I think it's happened in the last couple of games, so that can't happen. Especially, like I say, in the Champions League and in the Premier League, it can't happen. Whether it's a concentration thing or not, I don't know, but we need to be concentrated for the full 90 minutes, otherwise you get punished like we did tonight in the last 10 minutes. So away there, you can't do that. You've got to be focused for the full 90 minutes, and hopefully we can be next week.
And Rome showed in the last round they can come back, particularly in home matches. What is the game plan and going into that game for Liverpool next week?
Well, yeah, I'm not sure yet. Obviously, we've got another game in the Premier League, but we'll have to look back on what we need to do better, what we can improve on, also what we've done well, what hurt them, and then we need to take that into next week. But we've got a while yet before that game.
Thanks, Jordan.
And they'll certainly want to prepare very well in between then. Let's turn our attention now to another big fixture coming up tomorrow morning, Bayern v Real Madrid at the Allianz Arena. Looking at the statistics, Spider, 11 wins apiece and 2 draws. Now, I know you love to tip. If you had to pick a winner in this one, who would it be? Because there's very little that can be separated between the two statistically.
Confidently, Bayern will win tomorrow.
Is that right?
Yes. Bayern will win tomorrow.
Based on what?
But Real Madrid will get to the final.
Oh, okay. And what leads you to believe that?
Spanish have a really bad record in Germany. Mm. Really bad record. I know Real Madrid's one hell of a team, but so is Bayern, especially at home. I think Bayern will win. I think it'll be a close encounter, but I think Bayern will win at home. But I still think Real Madrid. I just think it's special. Like, they've won their last two Champions Leagues. I think Zidane's whole focus is to create history here and win three Champions Leagues in a row. That's an amazing feat for a manager who has just taken over probably the world's biggest club.